stand, join together as we sing, He has made me glad. He has made me glad.
I will enter His gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter His courts with praise. I will say this is the day that the Lord hath made. I will rejoice, for He has made me glad. He has made me glad, He has made me glad. I will rejoice, for He has made me glad. He has made me glad, He has made me glad. I will rejoice, for He has made me glad. I will enter His gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter His courts with praise. I will say this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice, for He has made me glad. He has made me glad, He has made me glad. I will rejoice, for He has made me glad. He has made me glad, He has made me glad. I will rejoice, for He has made me glad. We are standing on holy ground, and I know that there are angels all around. Let us praise Jesus now. We are standing in His presence on holy ground.
Thank you, Mabisi.
It's a joy to welcome you to Cross Baptist Church today. So glad you're here for worship. I want to take a moment and welcome those who are listening in to our live stream today. Thank you so much for listening, worshiping with us today. Thank you so much. Well, these are days that really we need to worship. We need to be praying with all the things that are going on around us. Not only is there the sickness, but there also is a lot of sin sickness. The rioting, the protesting, and all the things that come with that, plus the COVID-19, these are days when we need to worship and pray and ask Jesus just to take control. We're glad you're here. I'll leave it at that. I want to take a moment and recognize some very special people today. We recognized three graduates in our early service this morning, our university and college graduates. Andrew King graduated from Auburn University, and Blakely King graduated from Troy University, and Evan Moat from Trenum State Community College there in Montgomery. And so we recognized them earlier this morning. And now I have two high school graduates that I want to recognize. And I'm going to do this alphabetically. I'm going to ask Eliza to come, Eliza Chambers. She graduated from Eufaula High School. We're very proud of Eliza. She has her medallion. Is that a medallion? And your honors scarf?
Yes.
God bless you. Congratulations. We're so proud of you. Thank you. This is on behalf of the church family. Okay? And Megan White. Megan graduated from Quitman County High School over in Georgetown, and we're proud of Megan. Megan works in our preschool on Sunday mornings and keeps the church beautiful and clean. And we just spend a lot on Megan around here, but have Megan a Bible. And I told Tracy, I said, now some are going to look at that and say, boy, it's a lot smaller than the others. But she has chosen nursing as her career choice. And so I purchased it's called a Nurse's Bible. And it has about 40 devotions in here for nurses. And I showed it to her, asked her if she could be sure that she could read it. And, young eyes are wonderful, aren't they? But Megan, we say congratulations. We're very proud of you, okay? Let's give Megan a hand. It is a joy to recognize these graduates today. And these are Bibles They had their names on them, engraved upon them, and we wanted them to have that from the church family in recognition of this wonderful milestone in their lives. So you pray for them, and again, it's a wonderful joy to recognize them today. I want to lead us in prayer, and then Brother Van's going to come, and he's going to lead us in another set of songs, and John Everett's going to come and lead or share a special music, and then I'll share a message today. So let's bow our heads in prayer. There's so many that need our prayers today. I think of Scott Woodruff, who's in the hospital in Birmingham, and his mother, Carol Woodruff, she's in the hospital in Dothan. They need our prayers today. And of course, others, and again, our nation. So let's spend a few moments in silent prayer, and then I'll close our prayer time. Father, we thank you for this time of prayer today. I thank you for the prayers of your people. It's good to be together. It's good to worship you. And I pray, Father, your spirit would move in this place unhindered, touching our hearts, challenging us, convicting us of sin, moving us and motivating us to a deeper and closer walk with you. We pray, Heavenly Father, for those who are suffering from COVID-19 and other sicknesses today, we pray for your healing upon them. I pray for Scott. I pray for Carol today and ask your healing grace and your sovereign grace be upon their lives in these days. And you know their needs, and I pray, Father, you provide what they need. We pray for our nation today that is hurting. Not only do we need physical healing, Father, we need spiritual healing all across our nation. We have seen the depravity of man. We pray for our policemen and policewomen. We pray you'll keep them safe. We pray you'll keep them strong, give them courage in the midst of very difficult situations and circumstances. We pray, Heavenly Father, that all across this nation, people will turn to Jesus. He has the love that we need for one another. We stand against lawlessness, for lawlessness is a reproach to every nation. Father, help us to return to the golden rule, to do unto others as you'd have them do unto you. We recognize that the Bible teaches we're to love one another, no matter the color, no matter the financial status, no matter where they live. We're to love one another in Jesus' name. And I pray, Father, we'll return to that across this nation. That we can agree to disagree, but still love one another. And we know the only way that that's going to happen is to be spiritually transformed through the blood of Jesus. And I pray that a revival will sweep through our nation and spiritual healing will come. We know it's possible. And we know with God all things are possible. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
I am weak, but thou art strong. Jesus, keep me from all wrong. I'll be satisfied as long as I walk. my plea. Daily walking close to Thee, let it be, dear Lord, let it be. When my feeble life is o'er, time for me will be no more. Guide me gently, save me o'er, to Thy kingdom shore, to Thy shore. Just a closer walk with Thee, grant in Jesus is my plea. Daily walking close to Thee, let it be, dear Lord, let it be. O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds Thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, Thy power throughout the universe display. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to Thee. How great Thou art, how great Thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to Thee. How great Thou art. Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home. What joy shall fill my heart? Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great Thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to Thee. How great Thou art, how great Thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to Thee. How great Thou art, how great Thou art.
Thank you, let me say that.
That the Lord of all the earth would care to know my name, would care to feel my hurt. Who am I that the bright and morning star would choose to light the way through my ever-wandering heart? Not because of who I am, but because of what You've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who You are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow. A wave tossed in the ocean, a vapor in the wind. Still You hear me when I'm calling, Lord, You catch me when I'm falling. You told me who I am. I am Yours. Who am I? The eyes that see the sin would look on me with love and watch me rise again. Who am I that the voice that calmed the sea would call out through the rain and calm the storm in me? not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow. A wave tossed in the ocean, a vapor in the wind. Still you hear me when I'm calling, Lord, you catch me when I'm falling. You told me who I am. I am yours. Not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow. A wave tossed in the ocean, a vapor in the wind. Still you hear me when I'm calling, Lord, you catch me when I'm falling. And you've told me who I am. I am yours. I am yours. Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I fear? 'Cause I am yours.
Thank you, John Everett. Cale, appreciate that good word. Please take your Bibles and turn to 1 Chronicles, chapter 16 and verse 11. One verse will be the foundation of the message this morning. I've come with message 3 of 4 in a series that I've entitled The Healing That Must Come. I'm confident today that America not only needs physical healing, but spiritual healing. And I am praying, and I hope you are as well, that spiritual healing will come to this nation. The message this morning is entitled Seeking God. Consider the words of David. 1 Chronicles 16, verse 11, seek the Lord and His strength. Seek His face evermore. Notice the exclamation point. Notice the emphases. Seek His face evermore. The atheist and German philosopher of the 19th century, Friedrich Nietzsche, the man who started the dead or God is dead movement, told the story of a madman who lit a lamp one bright morning and went into the marketplace shouting, I seek God! I seek God! Many in the marketplace did not believe in God, and so they asked, is God lost? Has He gone astray as a child? Is God hiding? And they laughed Him to scorn. The man, however, did not give up. He responded, where is God? I will tell you. We have killed Him. You and I are killers. Nietzsche's point in that simple little story is that we have killed God by making Him irrelevant. Much of America would never say God does not exist. Much of America would not say God is dead. But you see, here in America, we live as though God is irrelevant. For most, he makes little difference, if any, in their everyday lives. Here in America, we live, we play, we procreate, we govern, and we die as though God does not exist. We have made him irrelevant in our lives, and we wonder why America has lost her way. As Solomon was about to dedicate the temple, he asked God, "What will it take for your people to live in a constant state of your favor?" And God came with an answer. And it's found in 2 Chronicles 7:14. "If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven, I will forgive their sins, and I will heal their land." In that word from God, we find four principles for the spiritual healing we need. First of all, there is humility and prayer. But then thirdly, there is seeking God's face. Seeking God persistently, seeking God consistently, seeking God intentionally. David puts it so well when he writes, "Seek God's face evermore." When Christian Herder was governor of Massachusetts, he attended a state legislature barbecue. He had been campaigning all day, hadn't had time to eat. So he was standing in the meal line, and he got there and he asked the lady for two pieces of chicken. She said, "I'm sorry, but one piece per person." He said, "But I'm starving." The lady said, "Nope, that's the rule." He then said, "Do you know who I am? I'm the governor of this state. I'm Governor Herter." And the lady responded strongly and confidently by saying, "Sir, do you know who I am? I'm the woman in charge of the chicken." King David served Israel with that same kind of tenacity. He was tenacious as a warrior. He was tenacious as a leader. And I want to draw from his life today in the message. Here's the background. The Philistines had stolen the Ark of the Covenant. And the Ark was extremely important to God and to his people. It was a box about 45 inches long, about 25 inches wide and deep. On top were two angelic statues called the cherubim. And between those two statues was the mercy seat. The Hebrews believed that God dwelt there between the statues. Inside the ark were the Ten Commandments and the miracle rod of Aaron, and also some manna that God had fed his people while they were in the wilderness. The ark resided in the Holy of Holies of the tabernacle. It symbolized the presence of God. In the heart of the people, bringing back the ark meant bringing back the power and presence of God. So David led Israel against the Philistines, and they recaptured the ark. And they prepared to bring it back from the battlefield to its rightful place in the Holy of Holies. The Philistines had been carrying the ark on an ox-drawn cart. It seemed like a pretty good way to carry it to David. And so he had a new cart built, and they put the ark on the cart. But you see, that was not God's way. God's way was to carry it on the shoulders of the Levites. You see, on each side of the box, there were rings. Poles were to be slid through the rings, and the poles were to be carried on the shoulders of the Levites. That was God's way. But David carried the ark his way or man's way. And the Bible tells us as they were traveling, the ox stumbled and the ark began to tip over. And Uzzah reached up to steady the ark with his hand and God struck him dead. David learned he must do things God's way. But in our text today, it tells us about the worship that took place as the ark was brought back and placed in the Holy of Holies. Beginning there in this chapter with about verse 8, David sings a psalm of praise. You know, David was a great musician. And all the psalms are songs. And so there in about verse 8, he begins to sing. And verse 11, you must hear him sing. Seek the Lord and his strength. Seek his face evermore. As I looked at that verse, I saw three significant words that need at least some apply or reply. The word seek is very important. It's translated from the Hebrew word bakash. It means to search out or to strive for. It's the verb. It's an action word. You see, you do the searching out. You search to know him. You search to find him. You search to do his will. The word seek means to search out. The second word that's so important is that word face. It comes from the Hebrew word panim, which literally speaks of the eyes and the nose or nostrils, and literally the whole face. It always refers to someone's presence. When you see someone's face, you see their presence. Brother Matt, was Charlie at church this morning? Yes, I saw his panim. I saw his face. That meant I saw his presence. The third word is that word evermore. It's a word that simply means continually. That's the way most translations translate the word, continually. The NIV uses the word always. But it comes from the Hebrew word tamid, which means or speaks of seeking after him daily, privately, and corporately when we gather together. But it is a word that speaks of continuously or intentionally or passionately. Seek the Lord evermore. Now the question becomes, how often do you seek the Lord? Do you just seek him on Sundays when you come to church? Do you seek him when adversity comes? I told the group in the first service, I had a friend that was in a store when a tornado hit. All of them gathered in a small room for safety. And my friend said, everybody in there was crying out to God. And then he said, God heard a lot of strange voices that day. Do you just seek the Lord on Sundays? Do you just seek the Lord when you have adversity in your life? The word here, evermore, speaks of continuous action. We're to seek him every day, all day, intentionally, passionately. Seek the Lord evermore. Now you may be thinking, preacher, that's not real hard to do. Listen, that's against our nature. That's against our nature. Man has not sought God. God has sought man. You remember when Adam and Eve sinned and fell from the state of innocence in the garden? What did they do? They hid. God came seeking Adam. God is the seeker. In the New Testament, we read where Jesus came to seek and to save those which were lost. God has always been the seeker. Man has sought his own way. Paul wrote to the Philippians, chapter 2, verse 21, for all seek their own and not the things of Christ. Isaiah chapter 53, verse 6. All we like sheep have gone astray, turning everyone to his own way. Friend, that's one of the reasons why spiritual healing tarries in our lives, in our churches, and in our nation. We seek our own way. We want to carry the ark our own way. And for spiritual healing to come, we've got to continually seek God's face. Now, with that introduction in place, I want to tell you today to seek God's presence continually. I'm talking about every day, all day. I want to share with you three blessings that are going to come. And what I'm really praying is that the blessings will become the motivation. Let me say that again. The blessing will become the motivation. These three blessings will motivate you to seek the Lord evermore. What are the three blessings? Number one, you will find favor with God. You will find favor with God. Proverbs 12:2 says, a good man obtains favor from the Lord. To have favor with God means you have God's approval. It means you have God's kindness. It means you have God's acceptance. When G. Campbell Morgan, one of the great Bible teachers of old, when he was young, he applied to a very prestigious seminary and he was rejected. He sent a telegram home to his father. He was obviously heartbroken and he just wrote one word to his father, rejected. And his father quickly sent a telegram back that said, accepted in heaven. You see, friend, what matters is where we are accepted. What matters is that we find favor with God. Now, I discovered that the Hebrew people believed that God's face was turned toward those who had God's favor. They believed if they did not see God's activity in their lives, if they did not hear God's still small voice, then God's face was not turned toward them and they did not enjoy his favor. This belief is found in Psalm 27, 8 and 9 when David writes, when you said, seek my face, my heart said to you, your face I will seek. Do not hide your face from me. Do not turn your servant away in anger. You are my help. You are my help. You do not leave me or forsake me. God continually tells his people, seek me. And David is saying in that psalm, I hear what you're saying. I will do what you say, but don't turn away. Don't turn your face away from me. Let me have your favor. Like the psalmist, the Hebrew people believed that God's face was turned toward those who were in favor or God's favor. Now here's the good part. When you seek God, you'll find God. Isn't that what the Bible says? Seek and you will find. A man's wife had died. The first night after her death was extremely hard on this father and his young son. The boy got into bed with his father. They both lay in the dark, but the boy couldn't go to sleep. And finally the boy said, Dad, is your face turned toward me? I believe I can go to sleep if I know that your face is turned toward me. And the father said, son, I'm looking right at you. The father or the boy went to sleep. But then the father crawled out of bed. He went over to the window and he looked toward heaven. And he said, Father, is your face turned toward me? Oh, friend, listen, when we humble ourselves and pray and seek his presence, we find his face turned toward us. It is his favor. And that is a blessing that comes when we seek His face continually. Number two, there's the blessing of being in fellowship with God. When we seek God's face, we enjoy fellowship with God. Now, when you become a Christian, did you know you establish a relationship with God? We call it being born again. Jesus said in John chapter 3, verse 3, unless a man is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. And verse 7, he says, you must be born again. To be born again literally means to be born from above. It's a spiritual birth. But when you're born from above, when you're born again, you establish a relationship with God. He is your heavenly Father, and it is a fixed relationship. Nothing can change it. November the 2nd, 1956, I was born the son of Jerry Helms. He's gone to be with the Lord now. But you see, I was born his son, I am his son, and nothing will change that. The relationship was fixed at birth. And it's the same with our spiritual birth. Once we're born again spiritually, our relationship with God is fixed forever. But it's different with fellowship. Yeah, fellowship is based on obedience. I've been out of fellowship with my father a time or two. Boy, he didn't take long for him to get me back in, though. But you can get out of fellowship with your earthly father by disobedience. It's the same with your heavenly father. When you disobey him, when you walk in habitual sin, your fellowship with him can be broken. Through disobedience, the fellowship can cause problems. Now, the Christian's got this unique position with God. He has a relationship that's fixed, but he also enjoys fellowship. And the better the fellowship, the deeper the relationship grows. To seek God's face, to seek God's presence means you have sweet fellowship with God. Now, there are a lot of Christians today who are out of fellowship with God. They're living in what we call a backslidden spiritual condition. Their life is focused on self rather than Jesus. The prophet Hosea spoke about this lifestyle in Hosea chapter 10, verse 12, when he writes, "Break up the fallow ground, for it's time to seek the Lord." Do you know what fallow ground is? I told the group earlier, my first and last attempt at a garden, I found out what fallow ground was all about. About halfway through the harvest time, I just finally let the weeds have it. But the next spring came, and I looked at that garden spot, and the frost had killed many of the weeds. But I want to tell you, that soil was hard, and it was uneven. I couldn't mow it. I couldn't plant new seed. And friend, that's fallow ground. It's hard. It's uncultivated. It is unbroken soil. When a Christian is living in a backslidden spiritual condition, their heart has become hard. They do not hear nor heed God's voice. They do not seek God's presence or God's face in their lives. And so the writer Hosea tells us what to do. He says, break up the fallow ground. Oh, preacher, how's that done? Well, you recommit yourself to intentionally seek the Lord through worship, Bible study, and prayer. Early in the semester, a student came by the professor's office during his office time, and she knocked on the door, and he said, come in. And she happened to glance one way down the hall, down the other hall, make sure no one was seeing her. She went in, and she closed the door. She said, Professor, I came by to tell you that I'll do anything to pass your class. She moved a little bit closer. She flipped her hair back. She did her eyelids, you know, batted them some. And then she said, I really want you to know I'll do anything to pass your class. And he got closer to her and he said, anything? She said, yes. He said, will you study? Listen, friend, that's our problem. We want to feel close to God. We want to have fellowship with God. We want to have favor with God. But we don't want to pay the price to study to get close to God. If we will seek His face, it means we've got to spend time with Him. And when we spend time with Him and fellowship with Him, we are a blessed, blessed people. So there's the blessings that come with seeking God's face evermore. You find favor with God. You have sweet fellowship with God. But there's a third thing and a final thing, and that is the blessing of following after God. David sings in this psalm, verse 11, seek the Lord's face evermore. It speaks of following Him, as I've said, intentionally, passionately, continuously. But the blessing comes in the perseverance. Now, I want you to hear that. The blessing comes in the perseverance. You know, when Jesus called disciples to follow Him, He said, follow me. When He called the crowd to follow, He simply said, take up your cross and follow me. Seeking God's face is following after God with perseverance. There are many who claim to love Jesus, but their faith has fizzled out. They're not persevering. They're not following God with perseverance. I read about a judge who had an inmate brought before his court. The inmate had requested an early release. The inmate told the judge he found religion. And the judge looked at the evidence and concluded the request was premature. He denied the request. The deputy sheriff took the man out and in a while came back laughing. And the judge asked the deputy sheriff, why are you laughing? And he said, I think the fellow who said he found religion just lost it. You ought to have heard what he called you out there in the hall. Friend, it has been said, a faith that fizzles before the finish was faulty from the first. Jesus said, follow me. David writes, seek the Lord evermore. It's about following the Lord and following Him in perseverance. It's about persevering to the end. The comedian Josh Billings said, consider the postage stamp. Its usefulness consists of the ability to stick to one thing until it gets there. Friend, I want to tell you, seeking God's face means you stick with God until you get to heaven. William Carey, the early pioneer missionary, his father didn't want him to go to China. In fact, his father pointed out to him that he possessed no academic qualification for such a task. And then he said to his son, what in the world can you do? And the son said, I can plod. P-L-O-D. I can plod. And that's what perseverance is. It's plodding from one day to the next. One challenge to the next. One difficult circumstance to the next. When you persevere until the end, you're going to be greatly blessed. When you get to the end of your life and you look back, you're going to be blessed by saying, oh, I persevered. I hung with Jesus. I stayed with Jesus all the way till I got to heaven. Nobody's going to be disappointed from persevering with Jesus. James chapter 1 verse 12 says, blessed is a man who perseveres under trial. Do you know what that word blessed means? It's a beatitude, you see. You find it in James, however, but the word blessed means happy. I want to tell you there's going to be a great blessing when you persevere until you get to heaven. Well, let me conclude. David says, seek his face evermore. Friend, if we're going to experience spiritual healing in our lives, in our church, and in America, then we're going to have to seek God's face, God's person, continuously. He's not hard to find, you know. He's not hiding. He wants us to find him. He wants us to know him. He wants us to do his will. He's not hard to find, but we must seek him. I'll close. A man was seeking God. He went to a palm reader. The palm reader read his palm, but he did not find God in the palm of his hand. He then went to a psychic, and the psychic told him of his life and his future. He did not find God in the stars. So he went to what was called a guru of the day, and he told him he was seeking God, and he did not find God in yoga or in meditation. So he found an old monk, and he said to him, I'm seeking God. Can you help me find him? The old monk took him down to a local creek close by, walked him into the water about neck high, took his head and put it under the water and held it there and held it there and held it there until he came up spitting and spewing. And then he said to that man, when you want God like a dying man wants air, you'll find him. You'll find him. Seek the Lord evermore. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word today. Thank you for its truth. We seek spiritual healing in our lives, in our church, and in our nation. And we recognize for it to come, there must be a seeking of God continuously, passionately, intentionally. And I pray, Father, that we today would be challenged through the power of your Spirit to seek you every day and all day, privately and corporately. We seek you in our lives. In Jesus' name I pray. Now, heads are bowed, eyes are closed. We're going to have a time of reflection and challenge. Can't preach a message like this without opportunity to respond. If you'd like to come to the altar and pray, you feel free to slip out of your pew and come. But I want to challenge you today to consider how you seek God in your life. Do you seek him every day or just on Sunday?